Welcome to Raptor J. We're glad to see you all this morning. So today, after service, we're going to have a business meeting. So if you are a member, please stay after service, and because we're going to have a vote over a decision. So we'll need you to stay just a few minutes after service. Then tonight at 6 p.m., the elders are going to meet. They're meeting a week early because of Easter. So they'll be here tonight at 6 p.m. If you'd like to speak to the elders about anything, please come. They'd love to speak to you. Then their meeting closes at 7 p.m. And Thursday night, everybody around here knows what that is.
Buckout!
That starts at 7:30. And if you're interested in riding, the registration fees are $20. Next Sunday is Easter Sunday, one of my favorite holidays. I think my favorite holiday of all. And we have a sunrise service at 7 a.m. Easter service starts at 10 a.m. And then the Easter egg hunt will be after the church service is over. Thank you all for those that donated candy. I think we got quite a bit for our little family. So thank you all for bringing that and remembering each week. We appreciate it. Saturday, April 23rd is the Jubilee, and we'll have a booth there. And thank you all for signing up to help Pastor Bob. And I don't know if he'll be reaching out to anybody in particular to help him set up, but he will let you know about set up either Friday or Saturday. And let's see, what else do we have on here? The next men's ministry meeting is May 13th at 6:30, and we encourage you guys to come and be a part of that and share in that ministry. Then the next elder meeting is Sunday, May 15th, and again, their open meeting is at 6 p.m., and their closed meeting is at 7 p.m. Then our next fifth Sunday is Sunday, May 29th, and we always have a potluck lunch after service. So you guys be thinking in your head what you want to cook and show off. We need dishes, like any kind of dish. The church will provide the main entree of meat and tea. And then you can bring breads or whatever your specialty is and desserts. We got to have those desserts. So that's all we have for the announcements. So you guys know I ponder all the time.
Pondering time.
Yes, it's pondering time. And I ponder, the majority of my information I ponder on is food. So for a couple of weeks, I've been pondering on my favorite, potatoes. There's all kinds of potatoes. And let me tell you something. If you meet somebody that says they don't like potatoes, don't trust them. Especially if they say they don't like mashed potatoes. Mm-mm, no, they ain't Texan, don't trust them. But this week, I've been thinking about all kinds of different potatoes. And thinking about the french fry and how wonderful french fries are. And I thought, okay, who has the best french fries? Is it McDonald's? Is it Whataburger? Is it Chili's? Chili's has some great fries.
Burger King.
Burger King? That's an odd one. So anyway, I love french fries. And I got to thinking about the history of french fries. So I was pondering, the first french fry was fried in France, right? Dawned on me after pondering. No, the first french fry came from Greece. Thank you, Mandy Goldring.
Thank you.
Jesus whispers sweet and low, fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Almighty Father, a blessed good morning to you. We want to welcome y'all here to Raffi J and thank you so much for coming out to worship with us today. But right now we want to start off like we always do. We want you to jump on up and greet your neighbor. Let them know you're as glad to see him as we are to see you. Well, all my life was wrecked by sin and strife. Discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus stirred across the broken strings. Stirred the slumbering chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry skies. I shall wake my flocks to worlds unknown. I shall reign with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Keeps me singing as I go. How are we doing this beautiful morning?
Great.
One person's awake.
We're quiet.
That's all I can hear. Y'all remember, I can't hear a whole lot of these things stuck in my ear. They kind of shut a lot of stuff out. So y'all got to get kind of loud. And it is okay to praise his name. Amen?
Yes.
We are celebrating Palm Sunday today, right?
Right.
Yes.
That's right. And that is all about praise. Amen?
Amen.
So I'm going to ask a question like I do every Sunday morning, but y'all answer just a little bit louder this morning. Are y'all happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning?
Woo!
All right. Well, it's so good to have you here. We're going to praise his name for a little while. And as always, that means making a joyful noise to the Lord. As you see, we're missing a couple guys today. Hopefully, we will all be back on next Sunday. So y'all help us fill in these missing pieces today. Don't be shy about putting your hands together and helping us out. Amen?
Yeah, in fact, there's a few songs that you're going to have to do just that. When we go silent, y'all need to be clapping. Amen?
So, get practicing. Here we go. Our Father in heaven, blessed be thy holy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us, Lord, as we forgive, and deliver us from evil temptation. For thine is the power, and thine is the kingdom, and thine is the glory forever. thy holy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give me this day my daily bread, and forgive me, Lord, as I forgive, and deliver me from evil and temptation. For thine's the power, and thine's the kingdom, and thine's the glory, the glory. And thine is the kingdom, and thine is the power, and thine is the glory, the glory forever. And thine is the kingdom, and thine is the power, and thine is the glory, the glory forever. And thine is the kingdom, and thine is the power, and thine is the glory forever.
Oh God, you are my guide, and I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my guide, and I will ever praise you. I will seek you in the morning, I will learn. Thank you. don't remember him. All he wanted was a Saturday. And anyway, brush by that wounded soul. It's Thursday afternoon. You met somebody who would die for you. Phone rang again last night. Who'd call it such a crazy time? Getting kids in the bath and bed. Can't talk about the things he said. All he wanted was a Saturday. Morning conversation down at Baker's Cafe. Weren't thinking when you told your dad, packing it with your tube, that you heard somebody who would die for you. Somebody who would care so much, they'd gladly give it all up. It's what they had to do. But it's deeper than flesh and blood. Heaven knows no greater love than the sacrifice they made to see us through. Somebody who would die. I don't know when these bullets came past, shattered more than the library glass. Asked her if she believed in your name, and she didn't even hesitate. God, I can't help but wonder if I'd been in their shoes, would I be somebody who would die?
One
passes the valley, and even now he is breathing on your dry bones. There will be dancing, there will be beauty where beauty was ash and stone. This much I know.
Time for one more this morning. We're gonna go back in the hymnal for this one here. So y'all been a little timid about clapping your hands this morning thus far. That's just what I see up here. So y'all don't be shy. Go ahead and help us out here. We're gonna do a little victory in Jesus. Amen. I heard an old story. How a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning, and I repented of my sins and won the victory. Savior forever, he sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again, and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to be the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my would go beyond the crystal sea, about the angel singing that old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved the air, I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He punched me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing just a second. Brother Bob's going to get that other microphone together, and he's going to be taking prayer requests, so y'all be sure to get those together. If it is your first time ever being with us, we just want to say welcome home. So good to have you here this morning. We do things a little bit differently. We don't pass an offering plate, but if the Lord leads you to bless the ministry in that manner, there is a little wooden church house right back there at the back door. And also right there are some little green sheets of paper, and you might see these in the seats ahead of you. If the Lord speaks to your heart today, you come to a decision for Him for the first time, please take a moment, fill that green sheet of paper out, and put it back there in the church house. It's the most important decision you will come to on this side of eternity. We just want to stand with you as you start that journey. Brother Bob, you there?
I think I am. All righty. Any prayer requests, guys? Yes, sir. Ooh, we about to go. I advocate get the kids out of school, homeschool something. Christian school, whatever. It's a dangerous place for our young minds to be. Yep.
My mother-in-law, she's having trouble with her eyes. She goes to the doctor tomorrow. And then for me, an unspoken.
Okay. You hear anybody? Yes, ma'am. Betcha. Anybody? Yes, ma'am.
Prayers for Marcella Jones and her family. She's she's got lung cancer and it can't be. You know, she just has treatments to prolong her life.
Okay. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
Just continue to pray for my dad. He's doing good. He hadn't been wearing his oxygen. He's doing no good with that. Without it.
That's good. Anybody else? Yeah.
A young lady at work, her daughter, mother's hope, and the daughter's 15, and she's going to be having a procedure this week, and we pray everything goes well.
Okay. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Anybody? All right, let's go before the Lord. Father God, we do love you so, so very much. Father God, you heard the prayer request. I couldn't keep up with them, but I know cancer was mentioned a couple of times. Father God, it always hits home with me. Lord, you healed me from the cancer that I had, my brain cancer. Father God, you continue to keep it at bay, and I thank you for that, and I praise your holy name for that. Father, if it were not for your might and your power, your strength, I wouldn't be here today. Father, thank you for your love. Thank you for your mercy. And we thank you for your grace. Father, you heard all these prayer requests. Lord, like I said, I can't keep up with them. Father, my feeble mind. But Lord, I believe that you knew what they were going to be before we did. Father God, I think you put into motion everything that needed to happen to answer our prayers. I think you're that awesome. I think you're that's part of your omnipotence, Lord, just Father, your sovereignty. Lord, you are the ruler of all. So, Father God, just I can't help but think about maybe there's a person here today, Lord, or maybe they're watching on Facebook or YouTube, Father, this has an emptiness in their hearts. Father, I pray that by the end of this service, that whoever is lost, whoever you're drawing to your Son, Father God, that they would cry out in his name and ask him to come into their hearts and feel the emptiness that they have. And it's in his precious, precious name that we pray. Amen. All right, kiddos, you are dismissed today. Is Palm Sunday. And what that signifies is that it's the... get to it. It is... It marks the triumphal entry of Christ Jesus into Jerusalem. The title of today's message is, get to it, the triumphal entry. We're going to be in Luke. All of the Gospels speak about this, but we're going to be in Luke today, Luke chapter 12, verses 28 through 44. You know, there's all kind of... we've seen them, some of them, the pageant trees, it's easy for me to say, right? Of these coronations of queens and different things, you know, just you'll see the horse-drawn carriages and just all the people dressed in just their best. I mean, the guards, the National Guards and things. Of the queen. This is like a queen's procession. And it's the regalia that's there. You know, just and it's just magnificent to see. But in contrast to that, on this day, actually it was, I think you could argue that it was Monday when he made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. In contrast to that, beginning this Holy Week, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords rode to his in his coronation on a donkey. Even a foal. Even a colt, the foal of a donkey. That's Zechariah 9:9. It's prophesied. Prophecy coming true. It was a humble coronation, as was kind of like his humble birth. Both lowly people attended, and the nobility ignored it, pretty much. But in spite of his simple coronation, he was nonetheless God's true king. Psalm 2:6 speaks of that. Out of all the earth, out of all the coronations of earthly men, women, queens, bishops, whatever, none of them compare and deserve the majesty and just the respect that Christ Jesus did. Amen. In fact, if you could just take the glory of men, the queen, like the Queen of England being going through her pageant, she and just her coronation, none of these even come close to receiving the glory that God needs, that he deserves. They're like a candle in the presence of the sun, just the bright sun-like. It's just nothing. Amen. Earlier, Jesus had passed through Jericho, where he had healed two blind men and brought salvation to Zacchaeus, the tax collector. Y'all remember that story? Zacchaeus, the little short guy, standing up in the tree. It was estimated, because this is Holy Week, this is Passover week, it's been estimated that there was about maybe close to 2 million people in Jerusalem at that time. Because it was everyone had to bring the sacrificial lamb for their particular families and other families if they couldn't afford a lamb to be sacrificed for their sins for the year. The annual sacrifice of the lamb. I don't think any of them realized what was actually going on, that while all of these lambs were being slaughtered for the forgiveness of the sins of Israel, the Lamb of God was being sacrificed at the same time. Amen. That was what the build up for towards it is going to happen. His arrival at Jerusalem marked the end of his earthly journey. Not the end of his journey completely, but at least the earthly part of his journey. But the people were still focused on an earthly kingdom. There are three scenes that take place here today that I want to talk about, and that is the preparation, the ordination, and the condemnation. Let's take the first one. The preparation, verses 28 through 35. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethphage, I don't know, but make sure I said that. Hopefully I said that right. Oh well, if I didn't. And Bethany. At the hill called the Mount of Olives. He sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden." I did a song because of that. Jesus is a cowboy. I'd have probably got bucked off of that little sucker. Untie it. And bring it here. If anyone asks you why you are untying it, tell them the Lord needs it. Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owner asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" And they replied, "The Lord needs it." They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on it, their coats, their cloaks on it, on the colt, and put Jesus on it. The preparation was prepared, put into motion way before this moment. It speaks of Christ, of God's omnipotence. I'll get it right here in a minute. He starts out by saying that after Jesus said this, and what he's speaking about is the parable just prior to what he's saying here. And ironically enough, in verse 12, chapter 19, verse 12, he says this, a man of noble birth went to a distant country to have himself appointed king and then to return. You see the irony in that? The parable that he was saying there? Mm-hmm. See, Jesus came out of his lofty throne. He is the noble among nobles, the Lord of lords, King of kings. Came off of his throne to be anointed king and then to return to the Father. Isn't that cool? I never noticed that until I was putting this message together. Anyway, just here and there, I thought that was pretty cool. But anyway, his prophecy fulfilled. Jesus said he had not been to Bethphage, nor his disciples. They had no idea other than what prophecy said. He had prophecy, and the prophecy of this is Zechariah 9:9. He says, Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you. This king comes to you righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt. The foal of a donkey. Prophecy fulfilled to the letter. Back way, way before this. So the preparation happened way before time. In fact, guys, I believe that God is so awesome, that he put into motion, like I said before, he created a thing in this universe. Each event that would have to take place in order for this donkey to be there, tied up, ready for Christ to ride. I believe that that was the actual preparation that was going on here. It may not be written in prophecy, guys, but I believe that God has a donkey tied up somewhere for each and every one of us. He's ready to answer our prayers. He's ready to meet our needs. The preparation has already been made. We just need to step out in faith and believe that God is in control. Amen. Not trying to compare us to Jesus having a donkey tied up, but the deal is that he has prepared for us. There is preparation for all of us and God in Christ Jesus. So that's preparation. Secondly, the adoration. Look at verses 36 through 38. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. One of the other gospels says that it was palm branches that they gathered and spread on the road as well. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples, and when he says disciples, that's not his 12 he's talking about all the people that's been following along. He's this gathering crowd to get bigger and bigger as he goes along, of those who were that he's been teaching. That disciple means that. It's all of the group of people. They began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. The other gospel say, Hosanna. Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Mark's gospel says that blessed is the coming King of our father David. Now when they're spreading their cloaks out, guys, what that represents is them being submissive to Christ. And it symbolizes them putting themselves underneath his feet as king, as their king, submitting to him as their king. And in the palm branches, that represents victory and joy and celebration. See, the palm branches were used in other places, like when the king would come back home with his army after a victory. And they would take palm branches and lay them out on the road as they came into the town. It is it's to celebrate the victory. So that's what those palm branches represented. Our Lord having victory. He was leading, guys. That's beginning this week, starting Monday. He begins a track that will finish up on Sunday morning when he is risen back to life. Amen. That's where the victory is, and that's when the victory is. When he ultimately pays the price of his own death, his own life, gives it for us on the cross. But the most important thing is when he raises up from that grave and comes back and brings himself back to life. John chapter 12, verse 16 says that these things, his disciples, meaning those his disciples, did not understand at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written on him, of him, and that they had done these things that, anyway, they didn't understand at first until they saw him being glorified. That's what John is saying there. Hosanna, that means save now. He speaks of, when Mark's gospel, like I said, when he speaks of our father David, well, that's the son of David. Jesus was referred to as the son of David. That speaks of his Messiah, being the Messiah. See, I believe that they realized that he was the Messiah. But they were expecting him to free the Jews. It was all about them that they were thinking. So they were thinking earthly. God was thinking spiritually. Amen? They were expecting a conqueror. You know, that does happen, but it happens in Revelation chapter 19 and 20 when Jesus comes back on a white horse. Amen? And we come back with him, by the way, then. We're riding in his posse. They were looking for an earthly king, just like I said. Let me ask you something, guys. Are you looking for a donkey? Are you riding on a donkey, the Jesus on a donkey? Or are you looking for the Jesus on a white horse? Amen. Jesus, in this church age that we find ourselves in, he's still riding the donkey. Because he has mercy for us right now. When he rides that steed, spoken of in Revelation chapter 19 and 20, guys, he's coming back to fight. He's coming back with God's wrath at that time. Amen? Number 3. Now the condemnation, verses 39 through 44. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." As he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you, against you, and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and your children within your walls. They will not leave this one stone on another, because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. The Pharisees knew that they couldn't quiet the crowd. Could you imagine a crowd of close to 100,000 and just a few Pharisees? What could they do to quieten that crowd down? And ironically, they asked Jesus to do it for them. That's kind of arrogant in itself, isn't it?
Yeah.
He said that some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher," and call him Messiah or Lord, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." And he said, "I tell you," he replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." The attitude of the people was joy. Jesus was sorrow. The crowd speaks peace, but Jesus speaks destruction. They pronounced on him glory. He pronounced on them doom. He said, "I tell you," that speaks of a seriousness. Listen up, what I'm telling you. It's important. It says, if it'll happen, guys, it did happen. It did happen. These people quieted down. And the next time Jesus heard from them is when they were screaming at him, "Crucify him! Crucify him! The blood be on us and our children." That's the next time you heard from them. So they were quiet. He said, the stones will cry out. Well, the word for cry here that he's talking about is actually a scream, is what represents a scream. It's not a joyful, but affirmation of God's judgment of Israel, his wickedness. And it filled the Lord with great sorrow, because his chosen people rejected him. And he knew that by the end of that week, by Friday, like I said, they were going to be crying out for his crucifixion, for his death. And it moved him greatly to the point that he was crying. When it says that he wept, it doesn't mean like a little choked down to tear kind of emotion. You ever seen somebody at a funeral? And especially when I've done black funerals, my black friends' funerals. When the husband is being the finality, when he's being put into the coffin, drove by, and then that lady just goes by, and she just bellowing, crying. She falls on her knees crying. That's the way Jesus was. That's the way he felt at that moment. Because he was moved, and he was sorrowful for the people of Israel. So from that point forward, for some 2,000 years, guys, they're still silent. They're still silent. But I thank God that he, in his omniscience, what did he do? He turned his focus on the Gentiles. That's us. And because Israel was supposed to bring salvation to the world. But their focus was on themselves as the chosen people, not thinking about the world. So God put them on the back burner, so to speak, and He used us to usher in the church age, the time of mercy and salvation, to take the gospel message to a lost and dying world. I believe that Jesus is still crying. I believe He's still weeping. I believe He's still weeping, like I said, crying like He did for Israel. Because Israel, salvation, He said, salvation's come to you this day. But they didn't recognize it. The Messiah they saw wasn't a Messiah that was going to save them. They thought there was going to be a victor, like a general or something like that. Someone would lead them into out of the bondage of the Roman authorities. I believe that Jesus is still weeping. And what I mean by that we are His chosen now to take His message into the lost and dying world. And Jesus knows that He can't, He says it. He said that that no one comes to Him lest the Father draws them. I believe that the ones that God is drawing to Jesus, when they don't answer, I believe He weeps because they're choosing hell rather than heaven, destruction rather than salvation. I believe He weeps over them. I thank God He didn't have to weep over me. Because when I heard the call, I said, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. So let me ask you guys, have you answered the call of Christ? Have you told Him yes? Is your Savior on a donkey or His own steed? Because right now, like I said, He's on a donkey. Tomorrow begins Holy Week. Guys, and I challenge you to trek along with Christ through this week. Because each day is marked in the Bible. Each day there's a significant thing that happens. And then when we come together next Sunday, we'll just put a good little period on it. Amen? We'll just have a finality. You know what I'm trying to say. A finale. The salvation that they were seeking, guys, on that day was an earthly, temporal thing. They thought they were going to be saved from the Roman authorities. But God meant it and still means it to be a spiritual salvation. We're saved from ourselves, from the destruction that all of us deserves. Like I said, guys, have you answered His call? Maybe He's calling you now. Maybe He's drawing you right now to His Son. I answered the call myself pretty quickly. He chased me for about, I don't know, a couple of 3 weeks, maybe a month. And how He drew me to Himself, to His Son, is that I couldn't turn to the right or the left without somebody talking about Jesus. and he chased me until I called him. Amen. Right now, guys, is the moment of salvation. You're not promised another day. You don't know what a day will bring. I shared with the folks on Thursday night that early on in my ministry as a pastor, there was a lady that came to me after services and said that her father was lost and he was up in age. And he was ill. But he goes to eat breakfast at TA truck stop outside of town. I think it's on a Monday, every Monday. She asked if I'd go down and witness to him. So I said, yeah, and I did. And I went there and I witnessed to him. And I led him to Christ right there in the pew, in one of the booths there, you know, right after we ate. And he was going to come to church the next Sunday. I was going to baptize him. And he wasn't there. He wasn't there. His daughter said that he had died maybe a day or two after I witnessed to him and he accepted Christ. That's cutting it close. And the point is, guys, you don't know if you're going to die tomorrow or the next day. It's so important that you answer Christ now. That you make the decision to receive this salvation now. This is the moment of salvation for you, not tomorrow, not the next day. If you want to ask Christ into your heart, you can do it right where you're sitting. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Say a simple prayer like this and mean it from your heart. Just have to admit to him, Lord, I am a sinner. And right now I turn from that sinful life. I agree, Lord, that you're right and I'm wrong. And I want to do things your way. So, Jesus, I'm asking you to come into my heart now. I receive you by faith into my spirit. I believe you died on that cross for my sins. That you rose back to life. You're living in me now. I recognize you as my God, my Lord, and my friend. And from this moment forward, I will serve only you in Jesus' precious, precious name. Amen. Said that prayer for the first time, guys. More importantly than that, you felt the presence of God begin to fill the emptiness that you had. Come see me right after services. If you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, my telephone number's right there. Like I say, you just Google Raptor J Cowboy Church, Terrell, Texas, and I'll bring up my telephone number there, my contact information. Guys, I'm serious about following along this week because this is, this is the most significant, the most important time in history. When Christ died on that cross, the Old Testament is looking towards it, and we are looking back at it. But everything is centered and revolves around that moment that Jesus died on that cross for our sins. That's why it's called B.C. and A.D., after death and before Christ. Amen? So trek along this week. Study God's Word. And just meditate on what really is happening through this week. I say we'll come back to church next Sunday and I will deliver a profound message that just speaks about the urgency of what Christ did for us and go into a detail. Bless you, Sandy. Let's pray one last time, God. We'll get on out of here. Father God, we love you so, so very much. Father God, we know we must be doers of your word, not hearers only. Father God, and we also know that this is the most important season in the year, Father God. We celebrate your birth, but the most important thing is your death and your resurrection. Because it's through your the love for you, for us that you had, Father God, by giving your son for us, that we can have a relationship with you. So until we can get back up here Thursday night, buck out, or next Sunday, we ask for your perfect speed, and we ask for your favor in our lives. We ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.